Yo, Haina, Koji, and Manabu going all out. Horikita and Kushida finally confronting each other. And Arisu revealing herself to Haina, Koji. Let's go. Our story begins at Palette Cafe, and right away we see an unusual bunch. It was Hirata, Haina, Koji, Horikita, and Kei. They were talking about the results of the Zodiac exam, and if you don't remember, here's how it goes. The answer relied on two different things, the alphabetical order of the group and the Chinese Zodiac. So for example, Kei was number 4 in her group alphabetically, and Rabbit is number 4 in the Chinese Zodiac, therefore Kei is the VIP. Kei complained about how easy this was, but Horikita's like, yeah, if you're sitting in a cafe chilling, of course it's easy to find out. But when you're in the middle of an intense exam with high stakes and no information, it's a whole different ballgame. Hirata raised an excellent point. Hey, if Ruin figured all of this out, why didn't he just crush everyone? And again, for those of you who don't remember, Ruin only targeted Class A during the Zodiac exam. They thought of a few theories, like maybe the existence of traitors within Class C, but nothing conclusive. They looked at Haina, Koji for answers, but our boy offered them nothing but a blank stare and excuses. But Kei kept her gaze for a few seconds longer, clear sign that she's now hyper aware of him. However, it seems Kei and Hirata had mended their fake relationship. Remember, Kei threw that giant tantrum when Hirata wouldn't go, you know, physically fight Manabe for her? They were back to good terms. Kei was even hugging Hirata's arm and smiling. Hirata proposed an idea. They should include Kushida, but knowing Horikita's relationship with Kushida, nah. Instant rejection. Horikita reasoned that with the four of them here, they could do anything Kushida could do. But she did take a jab at Haina, Koji, saying if only some of us could do a bit more. Yo, dude's been hard carrying from volume 1, what more do you want? After a bit of chit-chat, it was time for afternoon classes, and we're introduced to the main event, the sports festival. Let's go. Here are the rules. The major theme here are teams. The sports festival divides all students across all grades into two different teams, red team and white team. Let's take a look at this. You have classes D and A across years 1 to 3 on the red team, while you have classes B and C across years 1 to 3 on the white team. So how do they compete? Before I get into that, I want to talk about the point system, because the sports festival has its own. Going forward, I'll be calling them festival points so you don't confuse them with class points or private points. Students will compete to earn festival points, which then determine the winners and losers, which then determine the rewards. Okay, so what are the competitions? Well, there's two major types, all participant and recommended. Let's talk about all participants first, because they're the majority of events and they're exactly what they sound like. Every single student participates, so classes A to D, years 1 to 3. But listen, it's not like first years go head to head with third years, or else they'd get demolished. First years compete within themselves, and second years compete within themselves, and so on and so forth. All participant events can be broken down into two different categories. The first one, individual competitions. These are events where the individual's performance matters. For example, the 100 meter dash. Each year is divided up into groups with equal representation from every class. Here's a breakdown of the points for individual competitions. First place, 15 festival points. Second place, 12 festival points. Third place, 10. And 4th place 8. But if you come in after that, you lose points. So 5th place will lose 1 point. 6th will lose 2. It adds 1 with every single spot. Here's a list of all participant individual competitions. 100 meter dash, hurdle race, obstacle race, 3-legged race, 200 meter dash. Dude, this is just a tournament arc, isn't it? Next up, team competitions. And just like it sounds, it's events where you're playing in groups. And the winners get 500 festival points, so the impact is massive. Here's what's included. Capture the flag, boys only. Ball toss, girls only. Tug of war, separate for boys and girls. And cavalry battles, separate for boys and girls. Man, this is giving me My Hero Academia vibes. Next up are recommended events, and these aren't events where everybody participates. In fact, there's a set amount of spots, and the class chooses who will participate. And since there's a lot more strategy involved, the stakes are also higher. Let's do a breakdown of the points. First place, 50. Second place, 30. Third place, 15. Fourth place, 10. And just like everything else at the school, there's also major drawbacks. So this time, for coming in fifth, you don't just lose 1 point, you lose 2, and this continues to losing 4 on 6 and then 6 on 7. So here's a list of the recommended events. Scavenger hunt, 4-way tug of war, 3-legged race mix so boys and girls can team up, and the grand finale, the 1200 meter relay. This is the only competition in the entire festival that's mixed between all grade levels, so third years versus second years versus first years. Oof, this is gonna be spicy, and the points reflect that. For coming in first, you get 150 points. Okay, so that's a lot of stuff. So what do we get for it? Let's talk about the biggest category, red team versus white team. Remember, grade-wide. So whoever loses in overall points loses 100 class points. And what do the winners get? Drumroll, please. They get nothing. You get the chance to not lose points, as Sai put it so eloquently. So moving down from that, we have the category for every grade. So for example, 1A versus 1B versus 1C versus 1D. First place gets 50 class points. Second place gets nothing. Third place loses 50 class points, and last last place loses an ungodly 100 class points. Yo, so picture this. If you lose this and the previous category, you lose 200 class points. Next up is the MVP reward, and this is for the absolute Chad who gets the most points across every competition. That dude takes home 100,000 private points. And listen, you can't have Chad without the betas. So next we have the worst performing students. This is for the 10 worst performing students in every grade, and they don't lose something as simple as private points. They'll lose 10 marks in their next written exam. So if you're stupid, and we, God help you, Yamau, I mean you. The festival places a premium on individual competitions and has a separate category of rewards just for them. And this includes recommended events like the scavenger hunt. So if you take first in any individual competition, you'll get the choice between 5,000 private points or 3 marks on a written test. Second place, 3,000 or 2 marks. Third place, 1,000 or 1 mark. And if you come in last, you pay 1,000 points, or if you can't, you lose 1 mark on a written test. And last but not least, we can't forget penalties, because of course there are penalties. If you're caught doing fraudulent stuff, and really, emphasis on caught, you'll be immediately disqualified, forced to withdraw from the event, and all the points you've earned up till now, gone. Now, if you miss an all-participant event, immediate disqualification, no questions asked. If you miss a recommended participant event, you can pay 100,000 points for a substitute. The class had to decide amongst themselves who would participate and in what order. Once they decided, they would hand in a participation table to Sai. The window to submit this table started a week before the festival and ended on 5 p.m. the day before. If they failed to submit anything, they would be assigned at random. The only thing running through Horikita's head was her brother. Ainakoji teased her about this, but she wasn't in the mood. Class D had mixed reactions. For athletic students, time of their lives. This was awesome. Unathletic students, not so much. Sudo was pumped. His time had finally come. He wanted to enter every recommended event. Horikita was open to it because remember back in volume 4.5, she saw how good Sudo was. But Yamauchi and Ike weren't. They wanted the chance to win something. And as you'll see soon, they weren't the only ones. They moved to the gym for practice and everybody was there from class 1D to 3A. Ainakoji noticed that Manabu wasn't taking the lead. It was another student, Fujimaki. Following some motivational words, the students divided up amongst themselves. Hirata and Katsuragi got along right away. But soon, everyone's focus moved to a specific girl. She was petite with captivating short silver hair and cuteness that rivaled any girl. Her name was Arisu, the other leader of class A. Ooh, another best girl candidate. And that's not all. Immediately, we hear an argument in the distance. It was Ichinose and Ruin, and apparently Ruin wasn't gonna cooperate and walked away with all of class C. As the students left, Kei's eyes met with Manabe for a second, reminding her of the awful events back in volume 4. Katsuragi advised Horikita not to underestimate Ruin. As Ruin left, Arisu slowly whispered, "I wonder if he's gonna do something right away." Arisu then turned her attention to class DNA and apologized for not being useful during the sports festival due to her disability. She seemed like an absolute delight, mature and well-spoken. However, appearances can be deceiving. It was clear that class A was divided into two factions and Arisu had the bigger faction. She was likely using this event to show off her superiority. Listen, is it really a lolly if not smug? Arisu was absent during the Zodiac exam, the Island exam, and now the sports festival, multiple events back to back, penalizing her class every time, but she still had this much support. So behind the scenes, her accomplishments must be something else. Katsuragi had a strategy, just stay out of each other's ways. That means they wouldn't be sharing participation tables. Pretty Katsuragi move. Horikita slid back to talk to Ainakoji and asked him what the trick was here. Our boy's like, "What do you mean?" He enjoyed playing dumb. He explained it was a sports festival. Just like midterms measure academics, this measures your physical prowess. Horikita wanted to go deeper. What else was involved? In the other special exams, there were shortcuts. This felt the same. Ainakoji corrected her. Nowhere did the teacher say this was a special exam, and neither did the upperclassmen. So it's safe to assume it's not. Horikita was confused. If it plays out the same, who cares about wording? However, Ainakoji corrected her again. It's not. Think about it. And Ainakoji's right. The nature of these events are completely different. Picture the Island and Zodiac exams, both special exams. Was there any time to prepare? Absolutely not. They were thrust in there with little preparation. But think about the midterms. They were given a lot of time to prepare, but once the preparations are done and the exam is underway, you can't do anything else. However, during the special exam, all your strategizing is done while the exam is happening. That's the main difference. For special exams, you're tested while the exam's happening. For midterms and physical exams, you're tested before the exam happens. Ainakoji told Horikita to prepare, figure out what Class D's strengths are, pinpoint their enemy's weaknesses, what's their participation table, how do we stop them from finding out ours? These things are important. But Horikita still wasn't getting it, so Ainakoji asked her, "What do you think our advantages are?" Horikita's like, "Okay, C and B are fighting, that's gotta be good, right?" Wrong. Ainakoji understood at this point how how small Horikita's thinking was. She was so sheltered, she had no idea what was going on. Ainakoji explained that regardless of how Ruin acts, he's always trying to win. The festival isn't about sports, it's about your opponents, and only one matters at the moment, Ruin. What are his strategies? What traps will he set? What traps can be set for him? Those are the things that matter. If Horikita wants to get to Class A, this is how she needs to think. That's what Ainakoji has been doing. He's been studying Ruin since the events of Volume 2. He was surprised Horikita wasn't doing the same. Regardless, it'll be a good test to see how far Horikita can think. After practice, Ainakoji's just chilling out at his desk. He sent out an order and it finally paid off. He received a file on his phone. This worked out better than expected. He doesn't even need to set any traps. On his way back to the dorms, he ran into Sai, and after a bit of small talk, Sai asked him, "What are you gonna do about the festival?" Our boy's like, "Nothing particular." But Sai then reminded him, if he doesn't come through soon, she's not gonna keep her promise. If you guys don't remember, the only reason Ainakoji's helping Class D reach Class A because Sai is offering to protect him from his dad. Ainakoji's like, "Don't micromanage me," and then left. The festival was now a month away, and it was time to decide the participation table, and obviously, Hirata would take the lead. He introduced two systems, raising hands versus ability base. Let's talk about them. Raising hands, it's exactly what it sounds like. Students nominate themselves for participation. This gave everyone a voice and was the feel-good option. Another benefit is spreading the rewards equally among students, which is better. However, it could lead to arguments, say for example, two people wanted the same spot. On the flip side, the ability-based system found the best candidates and placed them accordingly. Biggest selling point, the best chance to win. The downside being, only top athletes get rewards. Sudo was obviously in favor of the ability-based system. This man took it a step further, saying he'd do all the recommended events by himself. His classmates weren't a fan of his cockiness, but they also weren't a fan of hard work, so if Sudo could handle it all, sure, why not? Horikita also spoke up, kicking things into overdrive. Not only did she want the ability-based system for recommended events, she also wanted to group students in all participant events with the best shot at winning, leaving all the dead weight high and dry. Shinohara wasn't happy with that, but Horikita's like, so? Facts over feelings. And this started an all-out war, with students like Horikita being in favor of the ability-based system and others being in favor of the raising hand system. And Ainakoji was about to stir the pot. He texted Kei, asking her to oppose Horikita's plan and to ask Kushida for her opinion. Poor Kei had no choice. She raised her hand, opposed Horikita, and then asked Kushida for her opinion. Kushida admitted that she was paying close attention and wanted an agreement where everyone was happy. That gave Horikita a chance to find a compromise. The winning students would use the points they get to boost the scores of the losing students. Win, win. But Kei stuck to her guns, demanding Horikita take their feelings into consideration. And she had enough social pull to rally a considerable opposition. Horikita wasn't loving this. Horikita unironically asked Ainakoji to talk some sense into Kei, not knowing this was all his idea. Ainakoji's like, "What do you want me to do? I can't control Kei." Ah, troll Koji at it again. The only way to settle this was a vote, and the results were in. 13 votes for Kei and 16 votes for Horikita. Kei wasn't happy about that loss because it cost her some rep. Horikita was also annoyed at Ainakoji because he stayed neutral. Smart man. However, the class had decided. Athletic students would participate in as many events as possible. Koenji was a candidate, but after Sudo almost got into a fight trying to convince him, they gave up on that idea. Kei met up with Ainakoji after class and asked him why make her do that, because Kei actually agreed with Horikita and the ability-based system. Let me explain why, because Ainakoji accomplished two things here. The first was to figure out how strong Kei's social pull was, and mission accomplished. Kei was the real deal. He had picked the right tool. The second was to see whether or not Class D would be double-crossed and have their participation table leaked. The prime candidate was Kushida because she already betrayed them once during the Zodiac exam, and I'll get to that in a bit. Ainakoji wanted to see where she was mentally, because usually Kushida is really proactive, taking part in discussions, but this time she was strangely quiet, taking everything in, likely gathering intel for her eventual betrayal. This is just my speculation, but when Kei asked Kushida for her opinion, Kushida answered in a way leading the class to a compromise, because the quicker they decide on a strategy, the quicker Kushida can deliver that intel to whoever she's making a deal with. Ainakoji complimented Kei. She pulled that off beautifully, but that's not the answer Kei was looking for. Ainakoji's like, "Man, if you worry about everything I tell you to do, you're gonna go crazy." Kei's like, "What? So I'm just gonna do everything you tell me to do like a dog?" Ainakoji's like, "Yep." Kei shot him a dirty look. She was pretty mad. Kei persisted, asking him who he thought was right, her or Horikita. Ainakoji's like, "Both of you could be right." Dude's the master of answering questions without ever answering questions. Not getting what she wanted, Kei switched it up, asking if he wanted to get to Class A. He gave her another Ainakoji-like answer, saying that at least Horikita believes that he is, for now. Kei shot him another glare, so he elaborated. He doesn't necessarily want to get to Class A, but it'd be good for him if they did get to Class A. Of course, he's not gonna mention his deal with Sai. However, he gave Kei a heads up. Someone would betray them during the festival and leak their participation table. Kei almost fell over in disbelief. She wanted more details, but Ayanokoji dismissed her, saying not now, and told her to get out of here because she was about to cause a scene. Before leaving, Kei asked if they would be okay, and Ayanokoji's like, yep, I've got a plan in place. The following day, the class was measuring physical capabilities, starting with grip strength. Sudo set the standard at 82.4 kilograms. Sudo wanted Ayanokoji to go next, but our boy's like, nah. But Sudo insisted. Ayanokoji did not want to participate, so he asked Sudo what the average was. Sudo's like, I don't know, 60? So Ayanokoji carefully used the device, making sure not to go over 60.6. Hirata remarked how strong Ayanokoji was. What? 60 is the average, right? Hirata's like, no, the average is like 45 to 50. Ayanokoji had made a big mistake. Asking a musclehead like Sudo was stupid. Sure enough, Ike came crying because he got a 42. In fact, nobody managed to get above a 50. At this rate, Ayanokoji would have to participate in recommended events, literally his worst nightmare. Sudo was like, wait, Ayanokoji is second? Yeah, we lost. His rudeness didn't help. Soon they had the initial participation table. This was top secret info. That means no taking pictures. In fact, participants only knew about their own events. Ayanokoji had to participate against his will, but Horikita told him to just suck it up. As the days went by, Class D practiced, and from time to time, they would notice Class A and B spy on them. However, Class C completely ignored them, almost as if screaming that they didn't need to spy. Horikita took Ayanokoji's advice to heart. She knew that even though Ruin wasn't spying, he was up to something. Our boy urged Horikita to think about it. Why was Ruin not spying? Why was he making it so obvious? Horikita tried to get the answer from Ayanokoji, but he's like, nope, that's all you'll get from me. At this point, our boy was certain Kushida would leak their participation table to Ruin. That's why he didn't need to spy. Sudo approached Horikita using her first name, and she was like, ew. But love-struck Sudo wasn't giving up and wanted to strike a deal with Horikita. If he gets first in Class D, she'll let him use her first name. Horikita's like, nah, son, you gotta get first in the entire year. Then they have a deal. At this point, Sudo will take what he can get. Also, Horikita added another condition. If he fails, he's forbidden from ever using her first name. As the days went by, it was undeniable. Sudo was the number one athlete, which prompted Kushida to push him into a leadership role, and even Hirata and Horikita agreed. So Sudo played the part, training his classmates and giving them advice, although he did have random outbursts from time to time. Horikita asked Ayanokoji if he was holding back during practice, and our boy's like, what you see is what you get. However, Horikita got serious for a second, asking if their preparations would be enough. Ayanokoji gave her some half-baked answer, but she called him out, reminding him that he promised to help her get to Class A. Our boy's like, what do you want me to do? Poison their food? If I did that, we'd win. No contest. Horikita told him to stop joking, and she was really starting to doubt whether or not practicing would be enough. Ayanokoji told her that she'd find out soon. I can understand where Ayanokoji's coming from. If you give a man a fish, he'll eat for a day. Teach him how to fish, and he'll eat for a lifetime. He wants Horikita to come up with these answers by herself, not just give them to her. So we fast forward to 2 weeks before the festival. Ayanokoji noticed some major problems. One, Horikita. She was physically gifted, but her teamwork is god-awful. While practicing the three-legged race, she refused to work with any of her partners, saying that they were too slow and they should try to keep up with her. He needed to fix this ASAP, so he told Horikita to compromise for the love of God. But she was as unyielding as ever. Realizing the thickness of Horikita's head far surpassed that of concrete, a different approach was needed. Ayanokoji told Horikita to partner with him once, just for practice. She was like, whatever, just don't slow me down. Oh, you sweet summer child. At first, Ayanokoji matched her pace, but then he went faster. Bit by bit, by the time he was at his regular speed, Horikita was struggling to keep up. Horikita complained, but Ayanokoji's like, what, isn't keeping up with your partner easy? That's what you said, right? But nah, this wouldn't be enough. So Ayanokoji amped it up to an absurd level. Horikita almost fell over and he had to catch her. Ayanokoji explained that the three-legged race isn't about speed, it's about rhythm. He picked up that lesson when practicing with Hirata. Okay, one problem solved, but the next one wasn't so simple. Kushida had massive influence over Class D, and her relationship with Horikita was shaky at best and destructive at worst. To get to Class A, they would need to work together, and for that to happen, they would need to confront each other. So the next day, Ayanokoji reached out to Horikita, saying that she needed to hang out with him tomorrow and that Class D's fate depended on it. Then he did the same with Kushida, asking her to hang out with them tomorrow. He made up an excuse saying it was about spying on the competition and it was all Horikita's idea. With the meeting set, he told Horikita to come walk with him. He asked her about the Zodiac exam, specifically the outcome of the Dragon Group. For those of you who don't remember, this is where everybody in the group got 500,000 private points and Kushida as the VIP got 1,000,000 private points. Ayanokoji had a theory. If Horikita and Hirata didn't betray the group, it was likely Kushida. Horikita asked why would she do that? It made no sense. Ayanokoji speculated that she likely made some sort of deal with Ruin. That was the point of their little field trip tomorrow, to find the truth. By the way, let me clear some things up. Remember back in Volume 4 where Kushida randomly just hugged Ayanokoji? It wasn't spontaneous romance. It was to draw Ayanokoji's attention away from Ruin, who she was meeting that night. There was also a scene back in Volume 4 where Ruin tried to record Ayanokoji Anokoji and Horikita's conversation. When Anokoji and Horikita found the phone, there was a single message on it saying, "I'm sorry." They thought it might be some sort of drama inside Class C, but no, that message was from Kushida. She was apologizing for having their meeting interrupted. There is more to the story, but it goes heavily into future spoiler territory, so I'm not gonna cover it now. But at the end of the video, I'll show you where to go find it. It's the hidden plot inside Volume 4. Early next morning, Anokoji met up with Horikita and Kushida, and they made their way over to the athletics ground. And after a bit of chatter, Kushida dropped the goody two-shoes act. She confronted Anokoji, saying it was all his idea to bring her out here, wasn't it? Anokoji tried to play it off, but Kushida was sharp as a T. They observed the soccer match with the hostile vibe still hanging in the air. One player stood out, Shibata. He was the ace of Class B and seemed to be good friends with Hirata. And after a bit, Nagumo entered the field and he seemed to be on good terms with Kushida, even teasing her a little bit. And once the dude started playing, he was on a whole different level. This was taking too long, so Anokoji just got down to it, asking Kushida why she hated Horikita. The only thing Kushida would say that it had nothing to do with Horikita and it was her own fault. But Anokoji noticed there was something else here, something that Horikita wasn't saying. This wasn't a one-way problem. Why was Horikita hiding that? After a bit, Shibata and Hirata came over and they made some small talk. When everything was coming to a close, Anokoji, Kushida, and Horikita decided to go back. On the way though, Horikita turned up to 100, asking Kushida if she betrayed them during the Zodiac exam. This caught Kushida off guard, but Horikita gave her an out, saying the past is the past and wanted to know if she would betray them again. Kushida assured them that all she wanted to do was reach Class A. That's what she said from the beginning. She wanted them to trust her. Well, Ainakoji's job was done. He said he'd leave the spying to the two of them. And Horikita's like, what? But before she could come up with any meaningful comeback, our boy just left. It was a week before the festival, time to finalize the participation table. Class D had a solid method. They looked at everything. Endurance, speed, grip strength. Hirata kept detailed notes. For the grand finale, the 1200 meter relay, Class D would use their best, which naturally meant using Sudo as the anchor since he was the fastest runner. However, Horikita wanted that spot and when asked why, she made some BS excuse. But no one was buying it, so she spilled the details saying her brother might be the anchor and she wanted to run alongside him. Sudo wasn't happy giving up the spot, but since it was Horikita, he let it slide. Ladies and gentlemen, we're finally here. It's time for the sports festival. Ike was all pumped up wanting to impress Kushida and Anokoji's like, how is he gonna impress her? He sucks at every sport. After the opening ceremony, it was off to the races, quite literally, because the first event was the 100 meter dash. Remember, this is the first of the all participant events, so everyone's included. It'll be ordered by grade level, so starting with the first year boys and ending with the third year girls. The boys, according to their years, will form 10 groups, 80 boys per year, so each group had 8 boys, 2 from each class. Also, this is an individual competition, so rewards like test scores are up for grabs. Sudo was competing in the first group, and a win here would be awesome for momentum. The race started, and sure enough, Sudo demolished the competition. It wasn't even close. Class D started with a first place victory, although the professor in that group did finish last. The races continued one by one, and the third race had some familiar faces, Kanzaki and Katsuragi. Anokoji noticed the sun bounce off Katsuragi's head magnificently. Koenji was also in that group, but as Koenji does, was absent and was disqualified immediately. Kanzaki won the race with Katsuragi coming in second. It was now Hirata and Ainakoji's turn. Our boy had quite the dilemma, how to not completely suck while still staying under the radar. Quite the Ainakoji problem. He started the race slow while taking the time to understand everyone else's speed. Then he upped his speed to a mediocre level. He took fifth place and Hirata took first. Mission accomplished. I don't think I've ever seen anybody try this hard to not win. That's really something. Afterwards, Ainakoji and Hirata arrived back at their tents and noticed Sudo gone. This could only be bad. And yep, their instincts were right. Off in the distance, they noticed Sudo confronting Koenji and rushed over. Sudo yelled at Koenji for not showing up, but Koenji barely noticed his existence. Sudo was steaming and threw a punch, but Koenji effortlessly blocked in the palm of his hands, reminding Sudo that in no universe would he ever win this. Apparently, Horikita had come beforehand to convince Koenji as well, but no luck. Hirata calmed Sudo down and they went back, but at this point, Sudo was raging. No one wanted to be around him. Sakura approached Anokoji out of breath, asking if he saw her race. Sakura was always the slowest during practice, but during the race, gave it her all. Anokoji told her she did great, which is technically not a lie. Next was Horikita running the 100 meter dash, and coincidentally, Ibuki was also in that group. And while Ibuki saw this as the ultimate showdown, Horikita barely even noticed her. The race began and Ibuki had a head start, but Horikita was catching up. Anokoji noticed that Ibuki kept looking at Horikita. If you don't remember, back in Volume 4.5, Ibuki has a massive problem with hyper-awareness. She thinks too much about the people around her to the degree it clouds her mind. This was her downfall. She kept looking back, allowing Horikita to catch up. Now, they were neck and neck approaching the finish line. Horikita being next to Ibuki kicked her hyper-awareness into overdrive. Her movements dulled, giving Horikita a chance to snag first place. Ibuki literally overthought herself into defeat. Sounds like every date I've ever been on. Just kidding, I don't get dates. From Class D, Hirata, Sudo, and Horikita all got first, but everyone else sucked. Shibata from Class B stood stood out, dude was a menace and was shaping up to be Sudo's only competition. Soon, the 100 meter dash came to a close, and here are the overall scores. Red team, 2011. White team, 1891. For now, Class D was on the winning team. Next up, the hurdle race, another individual contest. Same rules as before, but in this race, you had to navigate hurdles, and if you knocked one over, you lose 0.5 seconds. But if you even touch it, you'll lose 0.3 seconds. The track had 10 hurdles, 10 meters apart, and if you dropped them all, guaranteed last place. With Class D's poor performance, Sudo's frustrations only grew. He was acting like a tyrant, threatening everyone to do better. For example, the professor was sick and didn't want to race, but Sudo made him run the entire thing, even if he had to knock down every single hurdle, which he did. Ainakoji found himself racing alongside Kanzaki. Our boy tried to act harmless, but Kanzaki knew that he was fast. Apparently, Ichinose watched him closely back in Volume 2 when he went to rescue Sakura. Kanzaki confessed that he found Ainakoji's calmness creepy. Our boy's like, hey dude, feel free to judge. They raced and Ainakoji finished third place, maintaining his cloak of invisibility. Next up was Horikita and Sakura running the hurdle race. Hirata noticed something strange. Horikita's luck was terrible. She was an incredible athlete, but last time she got Ibuki, who was just as good. This time, two members from the track and field club, Kinoshita and Yajima from Class C, who were arguably better. And sure enough, they outclassed Horikita and she came in third place. Next up was the first group contest of the entire festival, Capture the Flag. And listen, if at any point you're like, dude, this does not sound like Capture the Flag, don't worry, you're not the only one. They're actually playing the Japanese version, commonly known as pole toppling. And here's how it goes. You have two different teams, red, which is DNA, and white, which is C and B. Each team is then divided into two different roles, attackers and defenders. Defenders get a pole which they must keep upright from the enemy offense. Yes, I know what that looks like. They form a defensive wall around the pole. Oh my god. The offensive team then must attack the pole to topple it. The official ruling states that when the pole is 30 degrees, it's down. The game goes in rounds, and when any team gets two captures, they win. In the first round on the red team, Class A would be defense and Class D would be offense. And on the white team, Class B would be defense and Class C would be offense. Finally, Sudo got to release his pent-up rage, but this wasn't free. Class C had a massive half-black, half-Japanese kid named Albert. Ainakoji wondered how strong that guy really was. The event started and Sudo went in right away. He sliced through the competition like a hot knife through butter. The Class B boys were rightfully like, yo, someone stop this man. However, it's a group competition, and although Sudo came in like a wrecking ball, hashtag Miley Cyrus, his team was useless. In fact, since this was teams, Ainakoji decided to be as harmless as humanly possible. Individually, the Class B boys could never match Sudo, but they swarmed him like a colony of ants. And on average, Class B was way more fit than Class D. Sudo was neutralized while Albert on the Class C offense demolished Class A. If Sudo was a wrecking ball, Albert was a nuclear blast. Hey, if this was studying, maybe Class A stood a chance, but Class C was full of savages under the leadership of Ruin. Within seconds, the white team took a round one. Losing to Ruin made Sudo's mental go boom. He started berating his team, lowering their already abysmal morale. Sudo taunted Class C to attack them, and he got his wish. Class C was on the offensive again. Ruin legit looked like a warlord leading his army of goblins. And if you thought Class A's defense was bad, oh bro. First hit from the Class C offensive and D was in shambles. Sudo yelled out trying to rally them, but nah, it wasn't working. Sudo was the last line of defense, but when Albert arrived, things got from bad to worse. The dust kicked up, creating a mini sandstorm, and this was the perfect camouflage for them to kick and punch Sudo repeatedly. Then the final nail in the coffin, someone brutally stepped on Sudo's back, twisting it until he was on the ground. It was Ruin. Sudo called out foul, but Ruin just chalked it up to the heat of the moment. With that came down the last bastion of their defense, and red team lost again. Sudo wanted to fight Ruin then and there, but Ainakoji and Hirata held him back, reminding him of the events back in Volume 2. Fortunately, the girls won ball toss, evening the score. Next group competition, tug of war. This should go better, less physical contact, meaning less chance to cheat. Hirata and Katsuragi also had a strategy, they would line up by height. This allowed them to apply pressure without unevenness, giving them an edge. And they did this right before the competition, giving the opponents a little chance to react. One problem though, half of the Class A boys weren't listening. This little rebellion was led by another Class A student, Hashimoto, who made an excuse saying he was skeptical about the strategy. Off in the distance, Ainakoji noticed Arisu smiling. Ah, so that's what this was. But Katsuragi handled this like a boss, saying that, hey, if we lose now, it's not because of the strategy. It's because Arisu's faction didn't comply, so the blame would be on her. This was enough to get them in line. On the other side, the white team almost had like no positioning. As calculated, red team won with an overwhelming advantage. Shibata begged Ruin to work with him, and Ruin felt gracious enough and told the Class C lackeys to get into position. They resembled a strange bow formation. Katsuragi warned everyone saying trouble is coming, and sure enough, the resistance they faced was insane. Something about the bow formation gave them immense strength. The red team caught off guard lost, bringing the score to 1-1. Okay, final round. This time the red team was prepared. The match started and it was intense, and just as things were neck to neck, Ruin ordered the Class C boys to stop pulling. The entirety of Class B came hurtling over, all of them yelling at Ruin. But Ruin just made an excuse, saying they were tired. Sudo's aggression grew, but Katsuragi stopped him, saying it wasn't wise to play into Ruin's hands. Katsuragi owed Sudo for his help back in Volume 4.5 and didn't want him to get into trouble. But so far, the red team had won 2 out of 3 group competitions, so things were looking up. Next up, the obstacle race, back to individual contests. The groupings were just like the races before, but this time you had obstacles, balance beams, nets, and a sack race. This race was as much about dexterity as it was about speed. EK gave it his all, but ended up with 6th place. On the other hand, Aina Koji barely tried and got like 3rd. It was now Sudo's turn, and he was up against Shibata, the matchup he was waiting for. And really, no one else in the group was worth paying attention to. The race began, and both of them were neck to neck until they reached the first obstacle, the balance beam. Sudo had incredible balance and pulled out ahead, likely from the years of playing basketball. However, Shibata was right behind him. Next up was the net, and the positions didn't change, and then the sack race. Sudo kept his lead, but as soon as the obstacles were over, Shibata started catching up. Ultimately, Sudo's lead was enough to net him first place. The races continued until it was Horikita's turn, but something was up. She was still against the students from the track and field club. This was too much of a coincidence to be bad luck. At the beginning of the race, Kinoshita bolted to first place with Horikita and Yajima as second, but once the obstacles arrived, Horikita showed off her skills, closing the distance, and by the time they were done the nets, Horikita had the lead. However, she couldn't maintain it between obstacles, and Yajima took first again, with her and Kinoshita struggling for second. But Horikita outmaneuvered Kinoshita in the sack race, taking second place cleanly. Aina Koji noticed something was up. Horikita kept looking back at Kinoshita. This wasn't like her, and it caused her to lose speed, bringing them neck and neck. And then catastrophe. Horikita and Kinoshita's legs became mingled, causing them both to fall to the ground. Kinoshita was injured, unable to continue, and Horikita got a disappointing 7th place finish. Aina Koji checked up on Horikita, and she was injured badly. She explained why she kept looking back. It was because Kinoshita kept calling her name. Horikita suspects the injury was deliberate. Good, she's finally catching on. But even with this injury, she's still determined to participate. Next was the boys' 3-legged race, same format, but instead of 8 individual boys running, it'll be 4 different pairs. First up was Sudo, and this man literally tied EK to his feet, grabbed him, and just ran to first place. Talk about being both physically and metaphorically carried. Next up was our boy and Hirata, and the painful part about this wasn't running. It was watching Hirata get all the female attention. On the bright side, since Hirata was fast, Aina Koji could let loose a little bit and come in first place. The races continued, and it was time for Horikita and Kushida's pair. They were off to a good start, but the injury clearly affected Horikita midway, and they came in last place, 2 terrible finishes in a row. This had to hurt Horikita's pride. Having time in between events, Aina Koji decided to do some spying. Class A was the same old story, Katsuragi and Arisu battling out behind the scenes. Aina Koji asked Hirata about Arisu, and Hirata was like, she's just as she seems. Polite, mature, and competent. However, he had heard rumors about her being very aggressive. For now, that's all Aina Koji needed. He wasn't dealing with her during the festival. But Ruin was a different beast. On the other hand, Class B was genuinely having fun. What mad lads. Following the break, we returned to group competitions, the first one being cavalry battles. This event was gendered, with girls first and then boys. Here are the rules. The time limit is 3 minutes. Every cavalry unit consists of 4 people. 1 jockey, or as I'll call them, rider, and 3 horsemen. 16 units in total, so a grand 8-on-8 battle. The players that make up the horse are not allowed to use their hands, but they can use their body and momentum as force. Only the rider on top can use their hands. There are 2 ways to knock out a unit. Every rider is wearing a bandana. If an opposing rider grabs your bandana, you're out. The other way is to separate a student from their cavalry unit. If you can forcefully do that, they're also out. But keep in mind, collapsing an enemy unit means you don't get the points. The only way to get points is to collect bandanas. Each unit's bandana is worth 50 points, but 1 unit on each side is dubbed the general, and that person's bandana is worth 100 points. The girls from Class D came together to create an elite horse unit, with Horikita as the rider and Ishizaki, Komiya, and Kondo, 3 of the fittest girls in Class D, as the cavalry unit. The other riders were Mori, Kushida, and Kei. The weakest unit here was Mori, that's why they made her the general. That way she can stay out of the fighting while the others can just go all out. The match started, and wouldn't you know it, Ibuki was a rider. And no points for guessing who her target was, but she wasn't the only one. Every single Class C unit went for Horikita, even though she was the strongest unit. Aina Koji knew right away this was part of Ruin's plan. What's worse is that Class A did nothing. Kei's horse rushed over, but she was battling her own set of mixed feelings. Before the cavalry battle started, Shinohara asked Kei if she had any type of strategy, and Kei's like, whatever. This confused Shinohara, because back in class, Kei opposed Horikita's strategy so passionately, giving off the impression that she cared a lot. Kei was annoyed. She liked Horikita Horikita's approach, it gave slackers like her a lot of breathing room. It was perfect. But because of Aya Nekoji, she had to go through all that trouble. The race started and Kei didn't expect them to target Horikita. Ibuki was the leader and her unit was the one causing the mayhem. Kei ushered Shinohara to go help Horikita. Even though she didn't care, she did not want to lose like this. But Ichinose's unit blocked her path. Kei wasn't all that physically gifted, and in normal situations like this, she would just give up, but she was determined to move forward. Why? Why was that? She didn't know, but she knew Aya Nekoji was watching. And the last thing she wanted to do was to lose in front of the person who knew everything about her. As expected, Kei's horse could barely keep up, but Ichinose herself wasn't so tough. Kei could take her. Kei looked back at the events of Volume 4.5. This time wasn't any different. Aya Nekoji gave her orders and she followed them. Normally this would suck, but this time it didn't feel bad. It's because her deepest worries had vanished. Manabe never approached her again, ever. Aya Nekoji had kept his promise. However, things came crumbling down. Horikita's unit fell. They would lose this. But for now, all Kei could do was focus on the opponent in front of her. Kei thought to herself, this isn't like her. She was slowly changing, but she did not hate it. After Horikita went down, it was a free-for-all. One by one, the red team units fell. The last unit left was Kei, and when everybody rushed her, she suicided, taking down one enemy unit. White team only lost two units, while the red team was wiped. When Horikita came back, Sudo comforted her, saying that it wasn't her fault. Class A completely abandoned her. Also, speculation here, I think Arisu commanded the girls to do nothing, since Arisu would have control over the girls in Class A. Watching Horikita lose, Sudo was determined it was time for the boys' cavalry battle. The elite unit was Sudo, Aya Nekoji, and Miyake as the horse, and Hirata as the rider. The ultimate force. Hirata and Katsuragi, watching the girls lose, had a strategy. The eight horsemen melded into one giant army and rushed all at once. Sudo was out for blood. He rushed Ruin, but an unfortunate Class B unit got in the way and got chewed up as fodder. Sudo as the horse could freely use his strength to body opponents. But again, remember, double-edged sword. You don't get the points if you just knock them out. You need to get the bandanas. Hirata urged Sudo to take out the units one by one. Sudo begrudgingly agreed, and it worked. They took down three horsemen with ease. This also gave Class A the chance to take down Shibata's unit, although they lost three of theirs in the process. After some cleanup, the only riders left were Katsuragi, Hirata, and another Class D unit, while on the other team, the only rider left was Ruin. Ruin taunted Sudo, bringing up the past competitions, and challenged Sudo to a 1v1. And just as if Sudo literally had one brain cell, he bought into it. Oh my god. Hirata tried to talk some sense, but Sudo was far gone, and Ruin sealed the deal by offering to bow if Sudo won. Katsuragi's like, dude, what the hell? But Sudo threatened to bust up Katsuragi's unit if he interfered. Sorry, I take that back. I don't even think he had a single brain cell. Hirata's like, fine, whatever, but you better win. And so the 1v1 began, and Sudo charged in. But Ruin's unit was no joke. The pillar was Albert, the half-black, half-Japanese powerhouse. His might easily matched Sudo's. In fact, Ruin's unit was overall stronger. While the cavalry units clashed, Hirata and Ruin were locked in battle. Their flexibility was even, but Ruin was conserving his strength to take on Katsuragi after Man was confident. Finally, Hirata outmaneuvered Ruin and grabbed his headband, but it slipped right out of his hands. He couldn't grab it. Sudo and Hirata were running out of strength, so they backed up, but Ruin looked fit as a fiddle. They had to end it now. Sudo used the last of his strength for a full frontal assault. Again, Hirata and Ruin were locked in a back and forth. Out of desperation, Hirata went for a full-on, suicidal last-ditch effort, and it worked. He grabbed onto the headband, but like last time, it magically slipped out of his hands. Ruin mercilessly grabbed Hirata's headband, and when Sudo realized, he fell to the ground. After Sudo was out, Ruin made quick work of Katsuragi and the other rider. Two back-to-back victories for White Team. Ruin celebrated extra loud, getting all up into Sudo's head. Oof, someone get the mind break tag. And boy did that work. Sudo back at the tents was going on a rampage. Sudo blamed Hirata, but Hirata mentioned the slipperiness, and sure enough, his hand was lathered in some sort of liquid. Aya Nekoji pointed out that wasn't normal. Sudo confronted Ruin, but Ruin at this point had hid the evidence and just brushed it off. Aya Nekoji figured it was hair gel because anything else would be too risky. Defeated, Sudo's mental was gone. He went full-blown caveman mode. Kei pulled aside Aya Nekoji and Hirata to try to remedy the situation. Aya Nekoji noticed Kei was using his first name, and he was like, why? Kei was like, she was already using it for Hirata, so why not try with him? However, she did drop the honorifics for our boy, which kinda ticked him off. Aya Nekoji explained to Kei that this was all Ruin's doing. He was even targeting Horikita, crushing her spirit. Ruin gave up a lot to mess with Horikita. Akita. He's the only one crazy enough to do that. Ainakoji's words came true. Kei realized that their timetable had been leaked. Ruen used it to set up his weakest lackeys against powerhouses like Sudo and Hirata. This also told Ainakoji everything he needed to know about Ruen. He was doing it in broad daylight, clearly taunting them. Kei asked Ainakoji if anything could be done, and Ainakoji's like, this is not my problem, this is Hirata's problem. To be fair, even Ainakoji couldn't salvage this. The preparations had to be done before the festival. Now all they could do was sit back and wait. Ainakoji knew Ruen had prepared everything carefully. Injuring Horikita, stepping on Sudo, the bow formation during tug of war, the hair gel during cavalry battle. Ruen took the time to practice and perfect all these measures, while making full use of Class D's major weaknesses. Mainly Sudo's temper and Horikita's pride. The results were already decided. Ainakoji asked Kei about her thoughts on Horikita. Kei didn't technically like her, but could empathize with her situation. She knew what it was like to be targeted by a bully. But Ainakoji gave Kei peace of mind, saying he had something planned. However, Kei misunderstood. It wasn't about the festival, it was to avoid an even bigger disaster. And speaking of disasters, Sudo was going berserk. Hirata tried to de-escalate, but Sudo was far gone. He blamed all his classmates for being so weak. But Yukimura spoke up, putting the blame back on Sudo. He was their leader, but all he did was yell and try to show off. Damn, man had a point. Hirata backed up Yukimura and Sudo just lost it. He smacked Hirata with bloodshot eyes and Hirata fell to the ground. Sai noticed this and came over, but Hirata quickly said nothing happened. He slipped and fell. Smart choice. Because remember, back in volume 4.5, Ainakoji cracked the code. As long as the school doesn't get a complaint, it didn't happen. But Sai stated she would still file a report just for safe measure. Sudo furiously left the tent. But before he did, his eyes met with Horikita for a quick second. Kei was like, this is bad. Ainakoji's like, not my problem. It was time for the last all-participant event, the 200 meter dash, and Sudo was nowhere to be found. Also, to put the moldy cherry on top, Ruen approached Hirata asking where Sudo went. Hirata kept his composure, saying Sudo went for a break, but Ruen called him out on his lie. However, Hirata was done playing nice and casually remarked how lucky Ruen has been so far. And when Ruen tried to play it off, Hirata straight up called Ruen out, saying that he knows that he has their participation table. Hirata promised Ruen, but at the end of the day, he'd see something special. Ruen didn't care. He had no reason to. He went on to win the 200 meter dash effortlessly. It was an hour until Sudo's competition. Ainakoji reached out to Horikita. This was all on her. She needed to get Sudo back. Horikita was like, why me? Oh my. Ainakoji had forgotten that Horikita was more dense than male harem protagonist. She actually didn't know Sudo had a crush on her. However, Horikita made excuses, saying she needed to prepare for her next event. Oh, this was a new level of stupid. Ainakoji started spitting facts, saying she can't lead anyone and she can't win her competition. She's useless. This jolted Horikita back to reality and she called out Ainakoji for being rude. She was injured. She had bad luck. There's nothing she can do. Our boy's like, is that really it? You think this is bad luck? If so, you have no idea what's going on. Horikita was at her limit now, yelling out, yeah, I know, we got betrayed, but there's nothing we can do right now. She was partly right. Ainakoji asked, what else? Horikita's like, okay, Ruen provoked Sudo, making him lose his cool. Ainakoji pointed out that even with the leaked timetable, Class C couldn't touch Sudo. Their only option was to sacrifice their weaker students. Sudo was undeniably the MVP. But Ainakoji wasn't done digging. He asked Horikita, what else? Horikita speculated. Ruen set a trap with her with Kinoshita, but she never thought he'd take that level of risk. It was apparent Horikita wasn't playing at Ruen's level. Ainakoji would have to expedite the process. He reiterated, Horikita is useless right now. If she doesn't start seeing the bigger picture, her dream to reach Class A will be just that, a dream. Horikita was about to yell out, but Ainakoji told her to calm down, think it over. Sudo left. Horikita was injured. Their timetable got leaked. Why did those things happen? Because Horikita didn't prepare countermeasures. So what happens next time? Because there will be a next time. Will Horikita cry saying it's bad luck? Is that someone who's gonna rise to Class A? Ainakoji told Horikita right now she had two options. Either try to salvage her competitions, which is really dumb because she can barely walk, or bring Sudo back. Ruen strategically relied on Sudo being out, so Horikita had to strategically bring Sudo back in. And with that, Ainakoji left, leaving Horikita to make her own decision. It was now lunchtime and Ainakoji found himself in the middle of a giant group talking to Kei and Hirata. He noticed Horikita was absent. Hopefully she's doing the right thing. Kei asked who the traitor might be and Ainakoji said that he knew, but he did not want to disclose it right now because it could cause chaos. The traitor needed to be dealt with quickly, but Ainakoji also pointed out that the traitor could be reformed. And of course, all of this was officially on Horikita's orders. This next part of the story is from Horikita's point of view and she fell down after Ainakoji's verbal beating. It wasn't because it was harsh, it's because he said nothing wrong. She went to the infirmary to get her leg fixed so she could search for Sudo. At this point, participating was a no-go. She had to pay 300,000 private points for replacements. And she had the means because remember, back in the Dragon Group, she got 500,000 private points. However, losing the once-in-a-lifetime opportunity opportunity to race alongside her brother hurt. On her way out of the infirmary, Horikita was approached by Kushida. Apparently, it was urgent. Kinoshita, the girl who injured Horikita, wanted to talk. They went back to the infirmary and met Sai. Sai explained that Kinoshita actually was blaming Horikita for injuring her. Horikita almost blurted out that it should be the other way, but refrained because making accusations without proof was risky. And it gets worse. Remember how Horikita kept looking back at Kinoshita because she was calling out her name? Kinoshita alleged that Horikita was looking back to find an opportunity to sabotage her. A complete fabrication, but hard to deny without proof because the cameras picked up everything but audio. What's worse was that Kinoshita was absent from all her events due to the injury. Horikita stuck to her story, but Sai explained that all the teachers knew, which means this case could go to the student council, which Horikita could not risk. With the current evidence, Horikita would lose. She competed in all her events, making her look extra guilty. Also, Kinoshita was scheduled for multiple recommended events and was a stellar athlete, so pinning this as a coincidence was really hard. Horikita's like, okay, I won't enter any more events, but that wasn't good enough for Kinoshita. She was keen on contacting the school. Horikita asked Sai where she found out about all this, and turns out Kushida was friends with Kinoshita and filled her in. Seems suspicious. But then things went from bad to worse. Ruin entered the infirmary, playing it off like he was genuinely concerned about Kinoshita. Ruin blamed Horikita for all of this, and with the evidence stacked against her, Ruin had a compelling case. Horikita finally understood the situation. From the beginning, Ruin was plotting this. He was weaving a web, slowly layering on events, a web Horikita couldn't escape. However, Ruin offered her a way out. Pay 1 million private points for damages, and to add insult to injury, Horikita would have to beg and kneel in front of Ruin. Sai said that's enough, and Ruin backed off. But he put Horikita on a timer. She had until the end of the sports festival to comply, or this would go to her brother. Ruin did his homework. He knew how to bend Horikita to his will. He ordered Kushida to bring Horikita to him after the festival. Leaving that awful situation, Horikita's will still wasn't broken. She needed to find Sudo. She searched high and low, but ran into the one person she didn't want to see, her brother. She walked past him in silence, but he reached out to her asking if she understood Class D's situation. Horikita only had one response. I'm starting to. The recommended event started, which unfortunately meant our boy had to participate. Sudo still wasn't back, so Hirata started subbing in students who needed the points. That way, if they won, they could actually use those points. EK won rock, paper, scissors and got Sudo's spot for the scavenger hunt. The rules were simple. You had to find the item you picked. And if you can't find it, ask for a redo, but you'd have to wait 30 seconds. The game ends when three people reach the goal. The game started and Ike rushed to Ainakoji. He wanted his left shoe. Why? Because that was his item. Ainakoji's like, dude, how am I gonna race if you take my shoe? Ike went to the tent, grabbed someone's left shoe, and took first place. Talk about luck. Now it was Ainakoji's turn, and what I'm about to describe to you, dear reader, can only be dubbed as a series of very unfortunate events. The first item our hero got was 10 close friends. Oh my. Just looking at the card was enough to make him faint. Dude barely knew 10 acquaintances, forget friends. He asked for a redraw. And the next one was a person you love. He's so screwed, dude. This was pretty much like confessing to someone. He asked for another redraw. His classmates looked at him like he was an idiot. He finally got something he could obtain, a table clock, but there were none in sight, so he ended up last place. Unlucky. On the other hand, Horikita finally found Sudo, and he was surprised, asking her why she came. Horikita didn't know. She couldn't find the words, but she told him without him, they were done. They talked about how things went down, and Sudo was still angry at Class D for messing up while he tried so hard. Horikita agreed Sudo was undeniably the MVP, but it's not cool to leave in the middle of competition. Sudo argued that he was not cut out to be the leader, but Horikita called him out. Didn't you say you're gonna carry Class D to victory? This got Sudo angry. Horikita knew there was something here. There was a reason why Sudo was like this. If she could find out why, she could free him from this vicious cycle. Horikita's like, fine, if you don't want to come back, hit me. Didn't know she was into that, but I'm not gonna say I'm surprised. And Sudo rightfully was like, you're weird, lady. Guess he's not into that kind of play. What a shame. Sudo confessed that initially he thought this would be easy, but Class D was too heavy. He hated losing because of his team. Horikita dug deeper and Sudo let it all out. He just wanted recognition and to show the haters what's up. But he failed miserably and ended up alone. Back to square one, back to how things were in junior high. To understand where Sudo is coming from, let's look at his monologue at the beginning of this volume. Sudo came from a broken family. His mom abandoned them to go into the nightclub business. So his father raised him alone, breaking his back to do janitorial work. Despite his rough upbringing, Sudo still had the guts to pursue basketball, and he got good, really good enough to get into a school with a
top-tier basketball team. But as Soro does, he got into trouble and got his recommendation pulled. That's when it all came crashing down. The one chance he had to escape his hellish life, gone. That event cemented one thing in Soro's brain. He came from trash and he'll never be anything more than trash. Horikita empathized with him. She knew what it was like to want respect. To fight alone, they weren't all that different. Two halves of the same coin. Soro just wanted to be alone, but Horikita wouldn't give up. She consoled him, saying that even if your family never achieved anything, doesn't mean you can't. But if you give up now, you never will. He had the abilities, he needed to make a stand, and until he would come back, Horikita wouldn't move from the spot. Soro was like, fine, do as you wish, and he entered the elevator. And as the doors closed, Horikita said one thing, I'll stay here forever if I have to. Damn. Anikoji never had this much problem with his tools. While Soro and Horikita were having this heart-to-heart, Class D was being eaten alive. They got destroyed in the four-way tug-of-war and dropped to the bottom of the rankings, and Hirata has been eating all the costs, solo financing the substitutions. He had spent 500,000 points so far. That's pretty much everything he earned in the Dragon Group. Kushida volunteered for the mixed three-legged race and offered to pay for herself, but they still needed a dude, and Ainakoji surprisingly volunteered, also offering to pay. As they made their way to the field, they caught Ichinose's attention, and she was feeling some type of way. Ichinose so far gave it her all. She didn't get any first place finishes, but she encouraged her team, and new Class B would come in first. In the mixed race, she was paired with Shibata, but once she noticed Ainakoji, her eyes were locked on him. The dude was a total enigma. Sure, in the festival, his performance was average so far, but there was something there. In the Zodiac exam, Ichinose caught a glimpse of Ainakoji's abilities. Regardless, Ichinose put aside her feelings and called out to Kushida and Ainakoji normally. But subconsciously, she called out to Ainakoji first. After a bit of chit-chat, the race was starting. Ichinose readied herself, but her mind kept shifting to Ainakoji. Maybe it was because he's so hard to understand. On the other side, Kushida was busy tying herself to Ainakoji, but he had an ulterior motive. He called out to Kushida in a voice that cut through the crowd. Kushida, you're the traitor. You leaked the timetable. Ainakoji got right down to it. Kushida denied the accusation, but Ainakoji pointed out how she took pictures of the timetable when it wasn't allowed. Kushida made excuse after excuse, but Ainakoji logically shot them all down. The two of them were close and tied together, making the talk both intimate and terrifying. Kushida countered, saying, hey, if you knew, why not warn the class? This was a dumb take. Anyone could inspect the list last second and leak it. But I guess she wanted to play, so Ainakoji decided to end her entire career. Why don't we just ask Sai-sensei, who specifically asked to view the timetable after we last turned it in? Fatality. Kushida was awfully quiet. The dark Kushida emerged. She admitted it. She was the traitor. She leaked the timetable. But Kushida still knew she was safe. She still had the uniform back in her dorm with Ainakoji's handprints on it from Volume 1. She had leverage. Ainakoji also confirmed the fact that she was working with Ruin as early as the Zodiac exam and asked Kushida what she got in return. One word, cooperation. Kushida laughed, knowing our boy read her like a book. Ainakoji told her to admit it, so she did. She wanted Horikita expelled. That's her deal with Ruin. Our boy had failed. He hoped getting Kushida and Horikita to talk would solve things. It didn't. Well, social skills were never his strongest suit. Ainakoji asked why, but Kushida didn't answer. The only thing she said was she would get Horikita expelled no matter what. Ainakoji asked, was it worth it if it meant destroying Class D? Kushida said it didn't matter as long as Horikita was gone, but she did make one amendment to her agenda. Now her goal was to expel both Horikita and Ainakoji. Then she would rally Class D and rise to Class A. Yo bro, this girl's writing checks she can't cash. Ainakoji just sat there admiring how stupid Kushida was. She could have done the smart thing like, you know, using a pawn, but she talked to Ruin using her real identity. She literally gambled on the fact that Ruin, you know, the guy that double crosses everybody, wouldn't double cross her. Oh my. The events continued and it was almost time for the 1200 relay and Soro was nowhere to be found. We cut to Horikita still waiting and the princess finally came down. Horikita tried to hide it, but this made her very happy. Soro noted that the festival was almost done. What's the point now? Horikita wondered as well. While waiting, she thought a lot about what kind of person she was and about what kind of person Soro was. They were the same. They were always fighting alone. Both of them wanted recognition. The only difference is Soro wanted it from the group while Horikita wanted it from one person. She talked about her brother, how he was always on top, always number one. And the reason their relationship is bad is because she lacks talent. That's why he doesn't want to associate with her. That's why she's working so hard for his approval. Soro didn't understand. Horikita was an elite student by any means. Horikita's like, yeah, but compared to her brother, she's far behind. Horikita wanted the anchor position because she thought if she did her best, her brother might actually cheer for her. But that dream was long gone. Ruin crushed her. It wasn't even close. Horikita finally understood her methods were flawed. She couldn't do this by herself. She needed allies. But one thing was for sure, she's not about to give up. That might be the only thing that separates her from Sudo. The way Horikita was working with Sudo was also flawed. She promised him when moving forward, whenever he goes off the rails, she'll bring him back. But in exchange, she wanted his help until graduation. Give me your strength and I'll give you mine. Horikita's message reached Sudo loud and clear. He accepted the offer. From this point on, they'll work together. Horikita felt a surge. It wasn't friendship or love. She had gained her first true ally and her first powerful weapon. As Sudo and Horikita arrived, the relay was about to begin. The first thing Sudo did was apologize to everyone. He'll shoulder the blame for the festival. He even bowed to make a gesture. Okay, Class D is back in action. Horikita, however, asked for a substitute and Kushida filled in. Miyake, another participant, also needed a swap, and can you guess who filled in? It's your boy Ainakoji. Class D's strategy was simple. Get Sudo to give them a huge head start. Here are the rules. This relay race was ran in groups with every group having 6 runners. Each runner finishes their distance and then passes the baton on to the next runner. Until the race is over, there were 12 different lanes, one for each class. Here's Class D's lineup. Sudo first, then Hirata, then Onodera, then Maizono, then Kushida, and Ainakoji took Horikita's spot as the anchor. All the big boys are competing, including Nagumo and Manabu, both as anchors. Remember when Hirata told Ruin that he would see something interesting by the end of the day? This was it. Ainakoji as anchor. The signal started and Sudo got off to a blazing start. He left 11 people in the dust. He passed on a solid 5-meter lead to Hirata, and Hirata kept that advantage. Next up was Onodera, and while she was fast for a girl, she couldn't keep up the lead. And by the time it got to Maizono, the advantage was gone. Nagumo's class was now number 1. By the time Kushida got the baton, Class D was 7th place. The seniors were on another level. Nagumo told Manabu it was a shame they wouldn't get to compete. Manabu asked Nagumo if he was gonna really change the school, and Nagumo's like, yeah. It was too soft, too easygoing, not enough people getting discarded. That would change. Nagumo and Shibata received their batons at the same time and set off. Now it was just Ainakoji and Manabu, and Manabu was surprised Ainakoji was the anchor. Ainakoji informed him that this was originally his sister's spot. The president has been watching Class D closely and said that they were hopeless. Ainakoji begged to differ, saying that his sister was changing. Class D would get stronger. Shame he wouldn't be here to see it. Manabu wasn't interested in fantasy, so Ainakoji changed the topic. Do you want to race? Ainakoji told Manabu that if he wanted, he would race him seriously. Manabu was just like, interesting. And right then he received the baton but didn't move 1 inch. Kushida would approach in seconds. Ainakoji readied his body and gave Manabu one last piece of advice. Run as fast as you can. Within milliseconds of receiving the baton, Ainakoji bolted down the track at full throttle. This was the first time he's ever run seriously in his entire life. Images flashed within his mind of running alone in a cold, sterile room. But the images soon vanished. His mind was clear. Nothing else mattered. Kei, Horikita, Hirata, Sudo, none of it mattered. He didn't even notice the other runners. The only thing that existed was the man next to him, the man he would beat. The scene blurred in front of him. The two of them cut through the wind, leaving several runners in the dust. You could barely hear the crowd. There was no strategy. There were no tactics. Only a one-on-one battle in its purest form. They reached the first curve and Ainakoji is like, nah, this ain't nothing. Time to go even faster. And within seconds, everything was over. Ainakoji awoke in his tent after the relay, Kei commenting on how fast he was. But our boy was like, I didn't win. Unfortunately, a runner fell in front of him, losing him precious seconds, enough to cement his defeat. Unlucky number 2. Don't think I forgot about the scavenger hunt. But that little stunt didn't just get him the attention of Class D, it got him the attention of the entire school. Everyone was looking at him. Even Sudo praised him, and Horikita poked him. She couldn't believe he held back again. But she did love the sick satisfaction of knowing he couldn't pretend to be weak anymore. As the festival came to a close, they announced the results. In overall points, Red Team won. For the first years, Class B was number 1, Class C was number 2, Class A was number 3, and Class D was dead last. So how does this affect points? Well, D lost 100 class points for coming in last in their year, and Class A lost 50 points for coming in third. C was untouched by that category, but since White Team lost to Red Team, they lost 100 points. Class B would have won something for coming in first in their category, but since White Team lost, they actually lost 50 points. So really, nobody won anything. And the MVP was Shibata. What, you thought Sudo would actually win? Dude, maybe next time he shouldn't skip like 50 events. As promised, Sudo would never use Horikita's first name, and Horikita was ruthless. She added another condition on top. Sudo isn't allowed to use violence unless justified. However, since Horikita also sucked, she let go of the first condition and allowed Sudo to use her first name. A Amidst the chaos, a quiet girl from class A, Masumi, approached Ainakochi. She wanted him to meet her later. 5 p.m., front gate, be there. Weird, but okay. His classmates thought it might be a confession, but Ainakochi knew his luck wasn't that good. They all went back to the classroom to change, but Horikita knew the worst was yet to come. She made up a resolve. She would bow to ruin. Kushida swung by and led Horikita to ruin. But before talks began, Horikita told Kushida to drop the act. Horikita knew she was the traitor. Horikita remembered they were both in the same junior high, and Kushida wasn't much different than she is right now. She had the trust of all her classmates. But something went horribly wrong. Kushida told Horikita to stop bringing up the past. Horikita now knew Kushida's objective. She wanted her expelled. Horikita said she could just tell Class D, but then Kushida countered by saying she would bring her brother into this. Horikita asked why couldn't they just ignore each other, but nah. Kushida was determined. Come hell or high water, she would get Horikita expelled. Kushida proclaimed she would get anyone expelled as long as they knew about her past. Even Ruin if it came down to it. Ruin said, enough talking, time to bow. But Horikita asked, was it worth it to sacrifice so much to get this outcome? Ruin's like, yep, his objective was to crush Horikita. Mission accomplished. Ruin claimed that he went as far as to have Kinoshita practice running into people and injuring them deliberately. And remember the brutal injury Kinoshita took? That wasn't accidental. He paid Kinoshita points in exchange for injuring her himself. He stomped with all his might on the ground to show how he did it. That's how far he would go. He laid it all out. However, unknown to Ruin, Horikita was recording this entire conversation. And when she revealed that, Ruin backpedaled, saying all of this was speculation, just a fantasy. Horikita's like, I can just cut that part out. But Ruin pulled a Uno reverse card, showing that he was also recording and he had video, which was better proof than audio. The last bullet in Horikita's chamber was gone. Ruin outclassed her to the very end, and just when Horikita was about to bow, Ruin received a text on his phone. It was just one video, and Ruin played it in utter disbelief. It was video proof of Ruin scheming with his class to target Horikita. It showed everything, even Ruin showing Kinoshita how to injure Horikita. This could get him expelled, no problems. Ruin laughed maniacally. He explained to the confused Kushida that there was a traitor inside Class C, and whoever sent that video had all three of them in the palm of their hands. It was the real mastermind. That person predicted Kushida leaking the table, that Horikita would lose. That person predicted everything. Kushida suspected Ainakochi, but Ruin said he was one candidate, but it's not 100%. Horikita, on the other hand, knew it had to be Ainakochi, because back when they were changing in the classroom, he was the only one who noticed that she had to go do something. Also, the race he ran against her brother was incomprehensible, so it must be him acting. Ruin, on the other hand, got a lot of what he wanted, so he just called it a day. On the other side of campus, Ainakochi was at the front gate, and Masumi led him to the third floor of the special building. A familiar figure emerged from the shadows. It was Arisu. She dismissed Masumi, and now it's just Ainakochi and her. She didn't say a word. She just stared at Ainakochi. It was as if time stood still. She finally remarked, you drew quite a bit of attention today. But before they could continue, Ainakochi had to send a quick text. It was the video that got Ruin to back off. Arisu started joking about the build-up to this meeting. It was kind of like a romantic confession. Ainakochi's like, what? Arisu slowly made her way to him, saying it's been a while since the last time they've met. 8 years and 243 days to be exact. Ainakochi's like, you must be joking. I have no idea who you are. Arisu chuckled, saying that makes sense. It's only she that knew him. Then, Arisu said one word that changed the entire mood. White room. For the first time in the entire series, Ainakochi's composure cracked. But Arisu assured him she meant no harm. This was just a greeting, a reunion of sorts. Ainakochi racked his head. He had no recollection of this girl. This was the first time he met her. Arisu proclaimed that they had a unique bond, but she was surprised to see him here. But now everything made sense. The island exam, the zodiac exam, Sudo's expulsion. No way Horikita pulled all of that off. Now that she knew who Ainakochi was, no one at the school mattered. But she assured him she wouldn't reveal his identity because she wanted the pleasure of burying the false genius that is Ainakochi. Our boy looked at her point blank and asked, can you bury me? Arisu chuckled with excitement, claiming she knew how impressive Ainakochi was and that she was looking forward to this, to annihilate his father's greatest masterpiece. Great, Ainakochi wanted that, for someone to finally destroy him, for him to lose. That would mean his old man would lose. That's what he wanted from the bottom of his heart. All right, let's talk about the number one question you have right now. Why did Ainakochi raise Manabu seriously? Dude spend the better half of the volume trying to avoid any and all responsibility. So why now? Why in the middle of the competition? Why in the most public way possible? Well, there are three main reasons, and the first one It's fun. Aina Koji came to the school for one thing, excitement, new experiences. You saw this at the end of Volume 4 when Ruin beat everyone. Aina Koji was excited. Finally, someone who knew how to play the game. This was his only chance to ever race Manabu. To get this type of thrill, he's not giving that up. The next reason was to throw Ruin off his scent. Aina Koji knew he'd have to save Horikita. She didn't prepare at all. And Ruin already had a target on his back. This was evident from Volume 4 when Ruin sent a spy to see when Aina Koji and Horikita were meeting. So how do you throw in doubt? Well, if you're the mastermind, you're not gonna do anything stupid. And what's more stupid than being so public at the last grand finale of the sports festival? In fact, it's plausible for Ruin to think that the real mastermind was manipulating Aina Koji from the shadows. That's why at the end, Ruin wasn't convinced that Aina Koji was the mastermind even when Kushida brought it up. And the last one is to keep Sai's cooperation. Remember Sai threatened him in the beginning of the volume? Class D was getting smacked, so Aina Koji had to do at least something to show that he was trying. But this also got someone else's attention, Arisu. Honestly, the introduction she had at the beginning of the volume is kind of boring, but man, that last confrontation, oof, that's spicy. The best part was when Aina Koji's composure cracked because she mentioned the White Room. So far, they seem to have a one-sided relationship. Aina Koji doesn't know about her, but she knows about him. Dude, the only complaint I had was that the scene wasn't longer. Give me more, elaborate. Well, no series is complete without a loli, so I'm glad Classroom of the Elite got its representation. What I'm not glad about is Kushida. I'm convinced at this point she's speedrunning being the most hateable character in the series. You know what? She really gives me Cersei Lannister vibes from Game of Thrones, in that she acts like she's more capable and intelligent than she actually is. First example, telling Aina Koji to his face that she's gonna get him expelled. She could have very well not done that. Just do it in secret, but no, she literally has the subtlety of a dying raccoon. And then she does it again. She tells Ruin to his face that she's gonna get him expelled if it comes down to, you know, the guy that's been running circles around your class. Please stop, get some help. I love how Aina Koji's like a competent schemer would have used a pawn instead of talking to Ruin directly. And even after that scene, we don't really know too much. The only thing we know is Kushida used to be herself before and then did some messed up stuff. Even Horikita's not sure, and Kushida's going after her because she might know. I don't know, man. Seems like a lot of work for just a maybe. Well, I guess going forward, Kushida's gonna ally herself with Ruin. I guess that'll be an interesting dynamic. And speaking of Ruin, dude, I am thoroughly impressed with this character. He's pretty much what Kushida wishes she was. An OP main character is nothing in a series if you don't give him a good villain. Dude, everything this guy did for the festival was so cool. If you read through the lines, he did exactly what Aina Koji was telling Horikita to do. First, he gained access to the participation table using Kushida. Then combined with the traps, he said he was able to easily take a lot of the competition. Like Aina Koji said, that's the bulk of what you need to win. And Ruin understood that from the very beginning. Not to mention the beautiful trap he set for Horikita. Dude, I did not see that coming. That was masterful. Another 1000 IQ thing he did, and it's really subtle, so you guys might have missed it. And I'm pretty sure he did it because I can't imagine Kushida would be smart enough to do it, is when he told Kushida to prompt Sudo to become the leader. Hirata is as cool as a cucumber. You saw it. Even when Ruin tried to rattle him, he didn't break. But Sudo, on the other hand, has the weakest mental known to man. So by prompting him to be leader and then breaking him during the competition, he got rid of both their best athlete and their leader all in one go. This guy's the epitome of street smart versus book smart. I like that. Also, yo, can we talk about Kay and Aina Koji's relationship for a second, because it's changing, along with her monologue during the cavalry battle and those little things like calling him his first name, relying on him whenever anything goes wrong. She's starting to see Aina Koji as somebody she can really trust, even with the messy start to their relationship. And speaking of tools, I know the author tried to really make this chapter about Sudo's redemption, but I gotta level with you guys, I really wasn't feeling it. It seemed like for more than half the volume, Sudo was just raging, and at the end they have some monologue with him and Horikita, and that kind of just fixes everything. I think at the end when Horikita and Sudo made that deal about Sudo being her weapon, that was kind of cool, and I hope they do something with that. But honestly, I feel Horikita got more development out of this than Sudo did. She's finally at a point where she understands she needs allies. It took what, only like 5 volumes? Also, if you click down below, you'll find the thread where they talk about the secret plot in volume 4. Shoutouts to user Veritas11, I really would not have found it. I did my best to cover it spoiler free, but if you want the entire thing, just go down below and check it out. Next up, we've got volume 6, What Happens After Aina Koji Gets Popular. Thank you guys for watching up till now. Leave a like, subscribe if you want more of this content, and I'll see you guys in the next one.